It's waiting for me to go live. There you go. Click on your little thingy there.
What thing?
On your thingamabob. Yo, it does it automatic. Look at that. I'm gonna do that from now on.
My hair's on point.
Huh? That's right. Your hair looks fantastic.
Thanks.
Yeah. Hey, everybody. Hey, everybody. How are you? Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training with my What Would Jeff Do Dog Training show of the...
Tip of the day. Show of the day.
Show of the day.
Week.
Hey, listen to me, Linda. I would do this show every day. I would do an hour show every day. In fact,
you'd have to get someone else to do it.
Are you ready? You ready for this? Ready for this idea? A 24-hour What Would Jeff Do marathon. Literally, 24 hours.
Literally.
And I'll do it as a fundraiser too.
Who's gonna do it?
Me.
I'm not gonna do it.
Me. And I'll swap out people. I'll get co-hosts. Joelle, you want to do it before you leave? How long can you last?
For this?
Yeah.
What did we do? Like almost 2 hours the other night?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Could you go 8 hours with a break? Do a little bit of a break? Yeah. I'll be on the air. We'll have to have coaches and food.
Awesome.
And yeah, get a mason jar, port-a-john. I'll just sit on a port-a-john.
Yeah,
that's disgusting.
What?
Yeah. Oh,
hey, Susan, right there. $20. Ask your question, Susan.
No, it's just
$1.99. I thought it said whoa. All right, guys. Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. Thank you so much for tuning in. This is the opportunity for all of you to ask your dog training questions. And just like Susan did, there's a little thing on the bottom there. It's called a
Whoozamajinky.
A Whoozamajinky dollar sign. Be like Susan. Click on that. Throw us some cash for date night. But I'm gonna answer your dog training questions. I have a training facility up here in Providence, Rhode Island. We specialize in aggression rate, rehab, and behavior modification. We do a lot of problem solving. We stop a lot of unwanted behaviors. So what happens is we also train dogs to be on leash, off leash. We can work with an 8-week-old puppy. We can show you how to puppy raise. We can work with dogs that are like got 1 foot in the grave. We deal with a lot of biting dogs. These shows tend to be a lot of people asking a question, how do I stop my dog from, and then fill in the blank. So you're going to hear me often talk about punishments. In fact, I just did a tip of the day on punishment. The only way to stop an unwanted behavior is through punishment. Ironically, today there was three trainers on. I had Lily and Brittany and Joelle on. They probably spent 90% of their day. So they literally spent 21 hours today combined, three people, 7 hours each, literally rewarding dogs. So, but when a dog does something that it knows that's wrong, you have to apply a punisher. And when you're trying to stop an unwanted behavior, you've got to apply a punisher. Now the magic is you need to learn how to properly punish. You need to learn how to properly punish. So that's the magic, and that's where I can help you. There's actually a proper way to do it, and it's important that people do it. There's actually also a proper way to reward a dog. I think most people reward dogs at the wrong time. People usually ask, why are dogs aggressive? They've been rewarded into it. Why do dogs jump on people? They were trained with a reward-based training program to jump on people. No, I don't want my dog to jump on people. You rewarded them to jump on people. No, I didn't. Did you stop it? No, therefore you said yes. The lack of no is yes. Always remember that. Always remember that. So let's get right into this. Joelle will be on the air the last 15 minutes, at the 1 hour mark. You're doing a podcast tonight?
Yes, I am.
Okay, so Linda's going to leave at 8:30. Joelle will pop on. You'll be able to ask her questions, or maybe Joelle will do a Facebook Live tonight asking her answering her questions. But she'll probably jump onto this one, and I'll probably have her do another one after this because I got some questions for her as well. So let's get going.
Things are getting pretty serious here.
That one right there. You know.
What?
Start with Colorado.
Okay.
Okay.
Do you ever believe in anti-anxiety meds for fear aggressive dogs?
Not to stop the aggression. No, it won't work. It won't work. So we've seen it actually make it worse. Now I'm not against medication at all. But you know, if you're going to do anything, you can do CBD oil. You're probably going to get better results out of CBD oil. Training fear aggressive dogs. Training stops that. Not anti-anxiety meds. If it did, I would recommend that and save people thousands of dollars. Training does it. Good dog training, people that know how to stop unwanted behaviors will do it. So very rarely, well, you have to be off drugs to come into our training facility. Very rarely will we recommend a dog need to go back onto drugs, maybe three dogs a year. And we deal with some of the worst dogs out there. I would say probably more than 50% of the dogs that we have come in are on drugs. And we have to get weaned off by the time they come in. But we're rarely seeing drugs work. Next.
This one's from Jake.
Yep.
Hey, Jeff, working dog on place, ignoring balls, rolling, bouncing by. When is Punisher delivered? As soon as she starts looking, staring, or once that foot steps off place?
Jake, depending on where you are in the behavior. So if your dog watches it goes by but never breaks command, who cares? Right? But if your dog, say, if your dog, it tends to break often, yeah, when they notice it. Next.
This one is from Lunira.
Yep.
In your opinion, what is the best way to socialize a puppy or young dog?
You need to find stable dogs. So you need to find stable dogs to be around, which is hard to do. So, and then you have to advocate for both dogs. And then you have to have other dogs that know how to interact with puppies. Or you could get a bunch of puppies together. You can do that. The problem with that is, which is a good idea, the problem with that is a lot of young puppies like to play with a different play style than some older dogs. The things that young puppies like to do sometimes piss off older dogs. So you need to find a dog that's a really good puppy raiser. But the bottom line is, I would never just have a bunch of dogs in a room and let them figure out how to play themselves. I'm always there. So we socialize dogs often. We socialize very difficult dogs often. So we're really good at socializing dogs that couldn't be socialized. Next.
This one's from Susan. How long do you have to use a Punisher? Camo will do well for a few days after I remove the prong collar and then is back to her reactivity.
Okay, Susan, first of all, can you lose 50 pounds in a month? No. Right? If you can't run a mile after 2 weeks of training, can you run a marathon? And I'm being serious here. First of all, prong collars are not just used to deliver Punishers. Stop removing a prong collar. Walk your dog on a prong collar for the rest of the dog's life. It's not punishing the dog. A flat buckle collar punishes the dog because it restricts free movement. Harnesses punish dogs because they restrict free movement. A leash punishes the dog because it restricts free movement. Keeps the dog from doing something. So why? My question is, I'm not mad at you either, Susan. Why would you want to remove a tool that's working? After 2 or 3 days, it's not going to happen. But plan on walking your dog. If you have a reactive dog, always have it on a prong collar. That doesn't mean you did a bad job training. It means you're smart and you want less stress in your life. So keep the prong collar on. But after a few days, not too much will work after a few days. Next.
This one's from Michael.
Yep.
If you teach a new word for the release command once he's learned a new word, but still listen to the old word, also, will correcting him for that cause issues because he's known that command for over a year?
So my question is, number one, why did you switch words? But no, it won't. It'll extinguish the use of that word. So if I have a sudden one day that I wanted to teach my dogs, they do. They speak German, they speak English, but they also speak vegetables and fruits. I mean, I can say anything to my dogs and they're going to do what I ask them to do, because why? We only do so many things. But if you have a dog and you don't want it to listen to English anymore, every time it listens to English, you correct it. And then you give it a new word. You absolutely can do that. So a lot of dogs were using, like, drop it. We use the word out. But what I would say is, why would you change the word if it was working? But so there's two things. But to answer your question, if you don't want the dog to listen to the old word and they do, you have to punish them for doing it.
He yes. also says, okay, I guess I just feel bad correcting my dog. Go ahead and be mean to me, Jeff. I need it. LOL.
Okay. No, well, I'm not being mean to you. I'm being a dick to you. There's a difference, right? So, I mean, this is the thing. Then you shouldn't, you know, if you feel bad, why the Frank Sinatra did you change the damn word? Right? So it's on you, buddy. You're the one that wanted to change the word. Hey, I think I'm going to change the word. So, all right. Don't worry about it, Michael. Love you, buddy. Next.
Okay. This one's from Lisa.
Yep.
What place beds do you use at your facility in the market? She needs a bed.
Oh, Petcot. petcot.com. Petcot.com.
Next. I never would have guessed that's the website.
Yeah.
This one's from Lori. What's the guy name from New York you said makes $10,000 a day, and does he have free advice on YouTube?
He makes more than $10,000 a day. He probably makes $1 million a day. But Gary Vaynerchuk? You're talking about Gary V. Yeah, everybody should know, everybody in business and in life should know who Gary Vaynerchuk is. His name is Gary V, and yes, he's got tons of free content. He put up 12 pieces of free content today. Next.
This one's from Susan. Cool. The flat collar is awful.
Yeah,
thanks.
A flat collar is designed to hold dog tags. It has one purpose and one purpose only. And the more dogs die on flat collars, you can't really harm a dog on a prong collar. You just can't. They look barbaric, but you really can't harm them on it. I've trained over 4,000 dogs on prong collars. We've had to give some severe corrections. Yes, severe corrections. Why? We work with really challenging dogs, and there's no damage that happens. Choke chains, yeah, you can do massive damage on a choke chain, massive damage on a martingale. A martingale collar is actually called a limited choke. Look up the patent. It's called a limited choke, but also that's what it does. It chokes the dog. That's the whole idea behind it. So big difference between a choke chain and a prong collar. So next.
Next one's from Michael. Because my release word was okay, too much of a common word, that was my fault for picking that to begin with.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Yeah, you would definitely want to do that because, like, if I say to my dogs okay, and if they broke, I would probably correct them. Definitely. Because my release word is break. So yeah. It's common. Okay is a common release word. The problem is we say it all the time. We say it all the time. And if you've got a dog, like a high drive dog, like me, and you're just having conversation and you would be like, okay. And then the dog's like, oh, I guess I can just like jump off place right now or break a downstay or we'll go through the threshold. So you absolutely can do it. But also you can start doing things like if you use the word break, say you can proof your dog. You can do things such as like saying, you know, steak, lake, make, bake. And if your dog moves, sorry, wait for the BR. Now, they don't know if it's called, they don't know if it's spelled BRAKE or BREAK. They don't know that much. But you could train them, though, to do it with letters. But guess what? They really can't read. People are using a hand signal. Like, they'll hold up the piece of paper, and they'll probably tap like that, which means to really break. There's all kinds of little codes, secret codes, like World War II. Next. The Indian code breakers.
Things are starting to get pretty weird around here. Keemed. I don't even know if I'm saying this right, but
KMD maybe.
KMD.
Yep.
As I'm walking my dog, he will shut down and stop walking, or he'll just lay down. Do I punish for shutting down on walks, or what's the best way to correct him?
Well, it's not that you're punishing him. Keep walking. Like, you're not gonna. If my dog laid down on a walk, I wouldn't go. Like, all I would do is be like, "Let's go, let's go." This is it. Chances are, unless you've got yourself like an out of shape dog or you've got yourself a bulldog that can't walk far, or we've had dogs come in, they couldn't even make it around the block because they're just so out of shape. I remember one Rottweiler could barely even make it around literally a quarter mile walk the dog couldn't do when it first came in. So it's not that you're punishing the dog, it's that you're going, like, you're just teaching the dog how to properly walk, you know, next to you. Next.
This one's from Kayla.
Yep.
My dog was becoming resource guardy of his toys after my mom's dog used to take all his toys. Since I've been correcting her, they started play fighting again. Oops, this question's disappearing. Hold on. Which is good to see. However, now when they play, they tend to both pick up toys and start fighting and teasing each other with them. To what point should I be correcting them for stealing from each other in horseplay?
So I'm not a big fan. I'm glad that they're not guarding anymore. I'm glad that they're horse playing. I don't like that type of behavior inside the house. I'm not a big fan of horse play in the house with kids or dogs. I like that for outside behavior. I guess if you had a couple of dogs, small breed dogs, like under 15 pounds, they were running around your house playing like that, and I was like, okay, I'll let them do it for 20 minutes, and then I'm going to stop it, shut it down. That's enough, guys. Cut it out. It's not the worst thing in the world. I can't imagine my guys. I got shepherds. I also have chihuahuas. I would let my chihuahuas probably horse play around in the house, you know, if I was, you know, supervised though. But my larger breed dogs, I really don't want running around my house. That's what we have out. That's what we have outside for. That's up to you. You set the rules. Next.
This one's from Kyler. If you don't have a punisher with you on walks with a prong collar and your dog is leash reactive, how do you correct? Pop leash and say and stay, or pop leash and leave?
Well, if you have a leash reactive dog, don't leave the house without a prong collar. Don't leave the, you know, your prong collar should be on. You there's not much you can do. I mean, you can do a heel tap. So you can do a heel tap. Popping your average leash reactive dog, a leash pop on a flat buckle collar or a martingale, historically is not going to be enough. If anything, you'll probably ramp them up. So get yourself a prong collar. Amazon has them for, I don't know, $25, you know? So $25. I'd like to think everybody has $25. Some people are like, well, I got to save my money. You don't have $25? Really? That's sad. It's probably called priorities. I mean, this isn't addressed to you. This is just, some people are saying that, well, I'm saving up for a prong collar. I'm like, don't own a dog. Sorry. If you don't have 25 bucks, don't own a dog. Again, this isn't addressed towards you. So get yourself a prong collar. What can you do? Literally go to a store and buy a prong collar and then use it tomorrow. So what do you gotta get out there. If your dog is being leash reactive and you have no tools, not much you can do. Like, just like turn around and go. Turn around and go. Next.
Kayla says they are small dogs. Not that I'm a huge fan of letting small dogs get away with things because of their size.
So I've got no problem. You know, I'm not talking about getting away with something. Like, here's a great example. I let my dogs play fight outside. I just don't want them running around my house. That's all. So the action is the same. The location is different. So, no, I want small dogs to be just as well trained and behaved and well mannered as larger dogs. So, you know, again, personal choice. Next.
Yes, Keem D is correct.
So Keem is the first name. Keem D is D. The last initial.
Keem D.
Awesome.
I got it.
Keem D.
I'll remember that.
Next.
Rachel.
I think he toured back in the late 70s, early 80s with Run DMC. He was in the Beasties tour of 1982. I like your album, Keem D. Next. Next question.
It's ridiculous.
Bro, you don't think I know my music history? Are you amazed? Are you surprised? Just because I grew up with Kiss and Styx and Journey and the Rolling Stones, that doesn't mean I didn't like old school rap. Do you know that I was in the basement, Cleveland, Ohio. I've been in some really intense house parties.
Sicily,
in downtown
1918.
You weren't even born.
I'm talking about the Golden Girls, people who are smart know that.
Go.
Okay. Rachel. Hey, Jeff, hope you're having a wonderful, beautiful day. Any tips for a dog that rushes the fence and barks and growls at dogs that walk by? I use the mini educator.
Yeah. Rachel, use the mini educator, right? Use the mini educator. You answered your own question. If I had a dog that ran the fence line, all right, at my house, whenever a dog walked by, I would have that remote collar on anywhere from the 80 to 100. 80 to 100. So 80 and up to 100, that little gap right there. And I would sit inside my house and I would wait until the dog ran at the fence line. And when the dog ran at the fence line, I would hit that button for a couple, let's hold that button down on continuous for a couple of seconds until my dog said, whoa, that was really uncomfortable. Now, a couple of things. Dogs can blow through mini educators on 100 if they're in drive enough. We see that a lot. I shouldn't say a lot. Certain dogs we see that with, and it's not a breed. It's not like a pit bull Rottweiler thing. I've seen it with a Jack Russell. So what you want to do is you want to make it suck to do that behavior, or else you're always going to be struggling with it. All right.
Kyler says, I'm asking, how do you correct with the prong?
Oh,
sorry.
Oh, I thought you said you didn't have it on you. Okay. So this is what you do. This is how you handle leash reactivity. First of all, Joelle's doing a Facebook Live series. She came up with this great idea to do a Facebook Live series. I think she started it a couple of days ago on how to size a dog. She'll do this. We'll talk to her afterwards. We'll do like a mini interview with Joelle afterwards. She'll tell you. But this is what you're going to do. Always think of this, Kyle. Think about alcohol and drug addiction. All right? We talk about
it's
this all
Kyler.
The time. Kyler. Think about alcohol and drug addiction, Kyler. If somebody is sober or trying to stay sober or trying to just not drink anymore, when are you going to have a conversation with that person? When they're already at the bar? When they've already had a drink? No. When they're thinking about going to the bar, or if something happens that you know is a trigger for them to pick up the drink or to do the drug. So what you need to do is you need to start recognizing your dog. So dog's walking around. You know it's leash reactive. I heard the narrative. You know the narrative. You're walking down the street. Keep your dog in a proper heel. Don't just have your dog out in front of you and then say, oh, shit, there's a dog coming up. I better rein my dog in. So prop, and also training is the dog's walking next to you. It's in a heel. No sniffing, no marking, no lunging, no barking, no turning right or left without my permission. And I want the head in a sort of up position. No, I don't do competition heels. That's not what I do. As soon as that dog starts beginning the sequence, such as boom, pop, right there. Got it? You got to get him at the beginning of the sequence. If you don't get him at the beginning of the sequence, now you're just chasing the behavior, excuse me, and you might actually be propelling the behavior. Next.
Wow. We have a few come in. Susan. Hey, guys, I can't figure out how to send money enough for a date. I hit the dollar sign, but how do I connect it to my bank account?
Oh, I don't know. Susan, I don't know. I don't pay myself. Try to pay me, Linda. Hit the dollar sign. You probably got to be set up in iTunes.
Send a super chat.
Send a super chat. You have to be set up in iTunes.
Wait, it said $2. Yes. Why?
What?
Oh, I can change it.
Yeah, you can change it.
Oh, okay.
So you have to probably, I think YouTube has to be hooked up to your iTunes account. Maybe somebody else can help me here. Next question.
I just want to see what's going to happen.
All right.
What do I do?
I don't know.
I don't know either.
But yeah, we have questions, Linda.
All right. Well, you're the one who started this shit. You tried to make me do it.
Okay.
All right. Here we go.
Lori. Linda, those looks you give, both of you are hysterically, ha-ha. Lori, hysterical.
I guess we're kind of funny sometimes.
All I know is this. We got questions. Come on, Linda. Stick to the job.
Lisa. See? Slave driver here. I've been thinking very seriously about getting into the training world. Right now, I groom dogs, including the ones others refuse due to behavior. Wondering, should I attend a T3 before or after?
So, Lisa, attend T3 before so you don't waste your money, time, thought process, everything. You can ask Joelle about that, too. You got all these questions for Joelle. So at 8:30, we're doing a Joelle Q&A. But it only can be about all the stuff that she can't take away from my show. I'm a selfish host. Actually, I'm not. So you can ask Joelle all these questions. But what you want to do is you want to save yourself some time. Write that question down. You want to save yourself some time. We'll cut about 5 years off your learning curve. And not necessarily the dog training learning curve, the business learning curve, the social media learning curve, the mental learning curve, the overcoming fear learning curve. Next. Did I just fart?
Rachel. Okay, thank you. I usually had it on 50 to 60, but I'll try 80 to 100.
Yeah, it's just a number, Rachel. It's just a number. It smells nice.
It's lemon.
Yeah.
I got you that for Father's Day.
Cool, thank you.
Susan, I want to listen to Joelle's live or a recording of it. What is her YouTube name?
I don't know if you have a YouTube channel yet.
I do, but it's on Facebook.
So it's on Facebook. Go to K9's. With an S.
Okay.
Yes. You need to register. I'll tell you that later. Register the other one too. So K9's in focus. Look at her Instagram page and her Facebook page. Next.
This one's from Keith. How did you teach girl to leave something from her mouth if you asked her for it? Is it a hard command to teach? Thank you.
How did you teach girl to leave something? Do you mean drop something? I just taught her the out command. Oh, just the out command? I think that's what you're talking about. If it's in her mouth and I want it, I just say out. And then she spits it out.
How'd you do it? How'd you treat
it? Oh, remote collar. Push a button. We have a video on it. So you can do it with a prong collar. Just don't do the switcheroo. This isn't JCPenney's. Don't do the exchange thing. Something's in the dog's mouth, like a ball. Hold up another ball. No. Or hold up a treat. No. It's in your mouth. It's mine. You're borrowing it like a library book. Give it back to me. Next.
Kyler says, thank you, sir.
Oh, you're welcome.
Robin.
Hey, Robin.
Question about paw raising. Yep. Dog used to do it more often before. Now her confidence is higher, so she doesn't do it in public anymore. When I'm petting her, she will lift it sometimes. Is that submission?
No, she probably has a question. Next.
That was snarky.
So, Robin, okay, don't even look into it. Don't care. Don't care what it is. Just don't care. Make it one of those things that, like, are, if you ask three dog trainers, if you ask five dog trainers what that meant, you would get five different answers. If I'm petting my dog, and if my dog, I also don't want my dogs to submit to me, and I don't want to dominate my dogs. I just want to be their leader. That's all. That's all. So, you know, don't care. Who cares?
Wouldn't it be like the hashtag paw here, don't care?
Paw here, don't care. It's a good t-shirt. It's good. It's nice. Next.
Oh, Susan says it was to be $20.
I have no, you can change it. I don't know, Susan. I don't know.
I don't know either.
Somebody donate $20 and then ask, tell Susan how she did it.
Or donate a dollar and see how to do it. Come on, Robin. Like anything.
No, let's go.
All right. Boop, boop, boo. Robin says, I have to switch my release word too from okay to break. I have guests over and in conversation they will say okay and my dog will release.
Right. Now, but now you can also fix that too, because you can make it so it only comes out of your mouth. But I also believe it's contextual. Like my dogs right now are sitting next to me. So my dogs are sitting next to me. Break. 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 They're not moving. Right? Because I'm not talking to them. How do they know you're not there? How do they know, Jeff? It's one of those wonders of the world. They know. Right? They know.
You guys are so connected.
You know, right? How did my mom know that I was on drugs? She just knew. Well, plus she also smelled it. But,
you know, so seriously?
Cool. Oh, honey.
You put Barb through a lot.
I put Barb through a living hell. I remember when she found
out. I don't know why she still talks to you.
Let me tell you the story. That I had a van.
I had a
1976 Ford Econoline van.
None of our daughters will ever go near a van, ever.
So anyway, I used to look out my window at night. I'd see her out there with a flashlight, like trying to look in through the windows,
really?
looking for contraband. Oh, it's like, God. Ma, you really think I'd leave it out in the open? Next.
Ma, go to sleep, Ma.
Yeah.
All right. Keith, any thoughts why my lab is such a fast eater? One cup of kibble in 8 seconds, and even worse, she's not chewing anything. She just swallows. Is this a behavioral issue that I should be worried about?
So, Keith, you know, I mean, this is the thing. It's probably not the healthiest thing, right? The healthiest thing, but it's also not the worst thing. What you can do is this. They make slow eater. First of all, you can use food for training. You can use the kibble for daily training, number one. Number two, take the food, spread it out on a cookie pan, or spread it out on the floor. You can do that. Get yourself a slow eater, a slow bowl eater. You can do that as well. You can do that as well. Next.
Aussie service dogs. I'm coming to your seminar in Seattle. How do you deal with dogs with mental trauma, potentially PTSD? I don't see any videos on it, and that is why I am
That's why you're
attending with my dog.
So Aussie, first of all, I'll see you in Seattle. It's coming up. This is the thing. We can get into the, you know, I don't know if you followed me or not, Aussie, if you've been following me for a while, but I might say to you, I don't care that your dog has PTSD. What's the behavior that it's struggling with? And let me show you how to fix it. Does that make sense? So sometimes it comes across cold and uncaring, which is sort of like my MO. If you talk to enough people, sure, he's really cold and uncaring. But I might tell you that I don't care that your dog suffered trauma in the past, because we don't like the dog's behavior right now. Does that make sense? So remember, they're dogs. So dogs in the wild, and I know we've domesticated them. But if they behaved a lot of the ways they behave in our houses now, they'd be dead. Fear forces a dog to either die or be assertive. That's it. Take your pick. A fearful dog in the wild will not survive. So dogs in the wild have to step up. The problem with us domesticating a dog is we allow them to stay in their fear states. The kindest and gentlest thing we can do with these dogs is get them out of their fear states. And sometimes it takes fear to do that, which a lot of people will say, well, that's wrong. And my response is, prove it. Because we do it all the time. We do it all the time. So dogs need to survive because you can't use a reward. Remember, reward gives you more of something. Always remember that. Reward gives you more of something. So I'll show you how to work the dog, but I might call you on your stuff and it'll never be disrespectful. It'll never, ever, ever be disrespectful. I don't blame, I don't chain, I'm not trying to upset anybody or be disrespectful to anybody, but I want you and your dog to have a better quality of life. So what I might say is like, okay, great, thank you for letting me know. Now let's train your dog. Next.
Okay. This one's from Roman.
Hey, Roman.
I have a heeler mix that hates boxers. He's never had a bad experience with them, but I believe it's their posture and facial expressions that cause him to become so reactive. All there is.
You have a heeler mix that hates boxers. You know what? Again, I once was at a seminar, and so a woman said to me, I've got a dog that's aggressive towards only yellow dogs. Only yellow dogs. That's it. And I said, bullshit. She goes, oh, no, it's only yellow dogs. You know what I did? I said, come here. I opened up my car door. Two German Shepherds popped out, and they're sable. The dog attacked them. So if your dog is selective towards just one breed, what do? It's okay. We fix the problem. So if your dog is going after boxers, so we stop the reactivity. So the question is, how do I stop my dog from being reactive towards a dog? Forget that it's a boxer. It's a dog. And reactivity, I already mentioned one way earlier on how to stop the dog's reactivity. What do? You punish the reactivity. Punishment is the only way to stop an unwanted behavior. I'm very aware of the conversation. I'm very aware of both sides of the coin. Some people now are going to say, then it'll have a bad association with a boxer. Well, according to the narrative, which I always listen to and pay attention to, it already is concerned about boxers. So it doesn't matter to me. It's that it's reactive. We can't have reactive dogs because then your world becomes really, 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 really small. Next.
Lori says hit $, then need to put password, and then that.
Okay, awesome.
I don't know.
Thank you, Lori. Yep.
When I put my dog in a down and she lies on her side and starts rolling, do I correct that? Sometimes I put her in a down and she's crawled over somewhere, but still in a down.
Okay. The crawling, you stop. Because next thing you know, your dog is too far away. And if you're at an outdoor cafe, that doesn't work. If I tell my dog to down and it rolls on its side, I don't care. If it starts rolling around, I usually do care. Next.
Pam B.
Yep.
My 8-month Labradoodle always scans and tries to sniff on walks. I pop with prong to do the e-collar. Will she even know why I'm shocking her? She does it constantly.
Yeah. I mean, you can use the word no. And this is the thing. You can do it with the remote collar too. The prong collar. You can do a 180 move. This is the big conversation out there from people that aren't big fans of remote collars. The dog doesn't know why you're punishing it. That's the big thing. It's like, yeah, it does. If you came home from work and you just like corrected your dog, well, then you're like, no. If a dog's barking and then all of a sudden you correct it with a shock collar, it knows why. If a dog's jumping, you correct it with a shock collar, it knows why. If your dog is sniffing and you correct it with a shock collar, it knows why. Because then you're also telling it to heal afterwards. But you can also say no. You can say no as a precursor. Say no, and then boom, do it. They'll figure it out. Every dog we work with has figured it out. So remember, you're not being mean to the dog. You'll be fine. Next.
Susan, nice. Our admin, Melissa, says when you click the $ for Super Chat and the box comes up, there is a dot online. That is a slider that changes the amount of the Super Chat you send.
Nice. She can read that too.
Well,
next.
I'm reading what's on the screen, Gellman. Jamoncito37, you had posted earlier about reprimanding the dog in a way they would understand. Could you elaborate?
Well, not reprimanding. I'm not sure what you're talking to. I talk about punishment all the time. I talk about punishment constantly. So all depends on, you have to figure out what's intolerable to the dog. And I would need a better example. I'm not quite sure what you're referring to, but we talk about how to punish. I've already mentioned punishment a lot here. So if a dog breaks, our go-to is if a dog breaks, say, a down, and they're only on a collar and a prong, you would say no. And if they already know a down, you would say no, and then you'd pop the leash. If they don't know the command yet, you just say no, and you put the dog back in there. But once a dog knows a command, I mentioned earlier that if a dog's leash reactive, at the beginning of the sequence of leash reactivity, you would give the dog a very firm pop with a leash or with a remote. So it's not a reprimand. I call it a punisher. I call it a punisher. You know, the proper term for it. So there's just, remember, there's no yelling, there's no screaming. You're not mad, you're not upset. It's just a matter of, it's a pretty unemotional act. It's a pretty unemotional act. So I'm not sure about which specific thing that you're talking about. You'd have to be more specific because I've got so many examples and I'm on social media so much.
Susan Next. Olson, thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome. Look at that. Oh, good. Thank you.
Next. You don't say you're welcome.
Thank you.
Okay. Ahmad?
Yep.
When is the earliest age that a prong collar can be used? I'm using one for my 10-month-old Samoyed, but unsure for my 4-month-old Malamute.
Yeah, a 4-month-old Malamute, 16 weeks old, absolutely. Introduce it properly. Don't use it for any harsh corrections for obedience at all, because your dog doesn't know anything yet. We do all food training at that age. But to get your dog to get a handle on the walk and maybe to stop some jumping or anything like that, you can start using it for. Next.
Okay, Roman.
Yep.
I tried desensitizing, but we don't run into them super often. And he goes absolutely ballistic the second he spots one. And we end up having to leave the park as he'll start to lunge, bare teeth, and to snarl. One time he was jumping around, snapping so much he bit me in the leg. Any ideas? He literally loves to play with all sorts of dogs, but if he spots a boxer even a block away, he goes nuts.
So this is the thing. So yeah, you got to go hunt some boxers and you got to go find some. So I'd call up, I don't know, I would go onto your Facebook page and be like, who's got boxers that I could use for dog training purposes? That's what I would do. Or I hate dog parks. Please don't go to a dog park. Go to a dog park. Wait outside. Talk to the local. See if there's a breed-specific organization. See if there's a meetup group with boxers. Ask them. But for leash reactivity, you've got to shut it down. You've got to shut down the reactivity. You can do that a couple of ways. You can use a bonker. This is a bonker. I made a bonker just for the show because I keep all my bonkers at work. It's a towel. You could say no. And you throw it at the dog. It's not going to hurt the dog. It's a towel. You have to do all this stuff at the beginning of the sequence, though. Remote collar, no, this. So the only way to stop all that reactivity is through learning how to properly deliver a punisher. So leash correction, remote correction. But there's a way to do it. There's a way to do it. You know, I've said.
Oh, geez. No, what the?
Hey, get some clothes on that kid. Thank you. Go.
Thank you, Lori.
Yep.
$1.99
cool.
Twice.
Thanks.
Okay. Yuko, any tips to train littermate? I have two Aussies who turned one. They both have reactivity with dogs and strangers. I use e-collar sport dog brand. Walk them separately every day.
Okay. So, yes, I've got a lot of weight. Two Aussies are turned one. You got your work cut out for you, getting two dogs from the same litter. So they recently have reactivity with dogs and strangers. So that's a lot of reactivity. The way to stop reactivity, we talk about this all the time. Number one, make sure you're using your that's my number one thing as we work on is reactivity. So literally, if you just train your dog how to remote collar heel, you'll get rid of 95% of reactivity. So remote collar healing eliminates reactivity 95% of the time or higher. And it's all about teaching the dog how to properly walk next to you. You're using a remote collar. You're getting the dog that's not aroused. You have to stop arousal. The dog should not be excited on the walk at all. If you're what you have to do is all this stuff that you're seeing out there with people using high-pitched voices and high-value food. And by the way, we do food-trained dogs. Every dog gets food-trained in our facility. But all this high-value food, getting the dog all ramped up, that's the worst thing if you're trying to eliminate reactivity. You literally are adding fuel to the fire. You want that dog to walk next to you, sort of like it's sort of bored. Don't worry. You can have fun doing other stuff. Play chuck it, play frisbee, go hiking in the woods. You can go take your dog swimming, do chick rate, chuck it, do trick training. You can do agility, do all that stuff. But the walk, I want the walk to be nice and calm. So teach your dog how to remote cower heel. We've got videos on that. Plus my buddy Sean O'Shea from The Good Dog, he's got videos on remote cower heeling. Master the remote cower, you'll master the walk. Next.
Aussie service dogs.
Yep.
What's an Aspie? I'm an Aspie.
I'm not sure.
So blunt and constructive. I respect. It's not uncaring and completely understanding. It is randomly now going after my other dog. Sometimes there are visible triggers. Other times.
So, not. So,
other
okay.
times not. It has caused an injury.
Okay. So what happens is if your dog's got into a fight, we'll go over this in the seminar. If your dog's got into a past fight, and now your dog is going, I'm nervous about you, and now I'm going to attack you. That's common. That's common. That's just a survival mechanism that the dog has. Some dogs can't live together. Some dogs can't live together. We get two dogs from the same family. Right now we've got two sets of dogs from the same family. I'm sorry. We've got two separate dogs from two different families, but there's two sets of dogs. And we just had a set of dogs go home. We deal with a lot of fighting dogs from the same family. And they fought with each other. In fact, we had two dogs just come in. They had cones on their head. We just took their stitches out today. We took the stitches out today. Literally, that's how fresh the last fight was. So some dogs can't survive that. Some dogs won't do well. Some dogs we recommend, you know what? No matter how hard you try, these dogs are going to have a grudge. They will. Because it also depends on your leadership structure. So... but there's always usually a sign. So you might not recognize it, but we do, but we'll go over it. We'll go over that. I definitely will give you a strategy on it. That's for sure. Next.
Did she just give us another?
It doesn't matter, but keep going. No, same amount. No.
Okay. You may have a really nice date now.
Nice. Thank you.
And admin, will you let me know if it came through?
Yeah, it came through. We saw it. Thank you, Susan.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Next.
Yuko, what do you think of slip collar? My dog listens better with slip collar than prong collar.
I would say 99% of owners can't teach their dog on a slip collar. It's very hard to train on a slip collar. If you're talking about a basic slip leash, it's very hard to train a dog on a basic slip leash. So if you've got the skills to do that, kudos to you. You also might have a dog that's doesn't need anything more than a slip lead. Most of the dogs that we deal with, and you know what? There's plenty of dog trainers out there. That's all they use is slip leads. The problem is the owners can't do it. The owners can't do it. So my business is not about us. Our business is about empowering the owner. Most owners need more help than a slip lead. But I have no problem if someone wants to use a slip lead, but just remember, if your dog's pulling, it could choke. It can get damaged. So if your dog doesn't respond on a prong, you just might not have to be able, you might just not be using the prong right. But it doesn't matter because the slip lead's working for you. If you're training your dog and it's working, we live in the city, guys, so that's why you're hearing all this, plus the windows are open. If you're training your dog and it's working, don't stop doing it. However you're training it, don't stop doing it. Keep doing it. So in a way, it doesn't make a difference what my opinion is because it's working for you. So who am I to say? So I feel very strongly about that. If you want to use, I could care less how people train their dogs. I really could. Just train your dogs. So next.
Jake, thinking about muzzle conditioning my dog, what things should I look for as far as fit and best way for dogs to get used to it?
We clicker train dogs. We use the dog's daily food and we clicker train the dog to get the dog used to the muzzle. We use Baskerville muzzles on most of the dogs. As far as fit, it does come with a size chart, so you can get help with that. The biggest issue is you want to make sure that it's not too snug where the dogs can't open up their mouth and it's pushing up against their nose, or when the muzzle is on, it pushes into their eye too much. The Baskerville muzzles, you can put them in warm water. You can actually stretch them a little bit, shape them a little bit to get the dog used to it, to get the muzzle condition. We do all clicker and food. We do clicker food protocols. Next.
Wander in blanket. I'm working on training my dogs on obedience. However, my fiance always cuddles and pets the dogs when she sees them. Could this make obedience training difficult?
Of course, yeah. I would do this. I probably download, there's two apps you can download, probably more than two. I would start out with Tinder and Match.com.
Oh, geez.
What?
The thing is, I knew that was coming.
Okay. So, you know, I would download those apps because what it's going to do is it's going to probably find, you know, the fiance might be an ex-fiance if he keeps this up. This is the thing. Nobody got a dog historically to not cuddle the dog. So I get it. But I think it's important that he understands that you're probably setting things back. If he's going to be the love bug, and if your dog has any serious behavioral issues, there's going to be major problems. If you folks decide to have children and he's been treating the dog as its child, you will have...
You got it backwards.
No, I don't. My fiance always cuddles and pets the dogs
when she sees them. You keep saying he.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You've got it twisted backwards.
He can download Match and Tinder. Same thing. Doesn't matter. I don't. Doesn't matter to me who downloads it. There's a couple categories in there, you know. So what you can do is she. It doesn't matter.
It does. It matters.
The other freaking human being in your house that is cuddling your dog, effing things up. Yes. Next question.
I'm just trying to make a personal connection with everybody, and you.
And I'm just cold and uncaring.
You're just ruining that.
All right.
I don't know where we are.
Hey, Anthony, how are you, buddy? Anthony, we need to get a date on the seminar in Nazareth, Pennsylvania, buddy. All right? Let's get it done.
Hey.
Unless this is... Go ahead. Go.
It's time for work.
Okay.
But Roman gave us $1.99.
Thank you, Roman. But AFT just said AFT checking in to say hi.
I know.
That was work-related.
Okay.
Next.
Mitchie Brokes. Just ordered my first mini educator. So glad I found you. Actually, through Bethany from Walking Dog Training on
great.
Instagram. I have a Great Dane and a Tiny Terrier. Can't wait to revamp their skills.
That's great. Bethany's wonderful. Awesome. Yeah, and Aussie is Asperger. You didn't know that? Autistic. Cool. We'll get along great. Next.
Okay.
Stephanie,
can a dog choke on a flat collar leash by lunging and dragging to the point of hurting its throat?
Of course, Stephanie. Absolutely. Flat buckle collar, martingale collar, and choke chain, and slip lead. Those four devices, you can easily hang a dog. Hold the dog up, it dies. You can cause massive amounts of trauma to the neck because it's a very large area that's I just choked myself. Prong collars are designed as barbaric as they look.
Man dies on YouTube Live, chokes himself.
That's not even funny.
It's awful.
Why would you even joke about that? Because people do that.
It's an accident, though.
But why would you even joke about that?
I'm sorry.
Why are you moving my keyboard?
I don't know.
Okay? You get your own keyboard, okay? Yes, so yes, the dog could choke. Next.
Sorry. Jam and Cito?
Yep.
I really, for some reason, my thing keeps jumping.
All right.
Thank you. My new dog. I don't know.
Something Thunderstorm
reactive. And the weird part is every once in a while he wakes up as if it's storming outside. It's strange. The problem is he growls and shakes really bad.
Yeah. So Thunderstorm phobia can be challenging to do. A lot of people are using CBD oil. This is the only thing that I do with when it comes to thunderstorms. The problem is it's hard to simulate it because it's hard to simulate the thunderstorm because of the barometric pressure. Like fireworks you can do, right? Trucks you can do, sirens you can do. But the barometric pressure you cannot do. So what you want to do is if my dog is lying down shaking, there's not much I do about it. If it was trying to like, if it was moving around, I would stop the movement. So I stopped the physical aspect of the freaking out, if we want to use that word. And I tell the dog to either go to place or go to into a down, or it can go in its kennel and lie down. And then what happens is the dog starts processing it. But a lot of people are using CBD very successfully. Next. And you're doing that. They're doing the THC. They're doing the good stuff. Next.
Stephanie, I have an appointment to get my GSD fixed 2 days after coming back from board and train. Should I try to space that out more so she can work on her training for a little bit at home?
Where are you? You missed a question.
No, I didn't.
Where are you?
Right here.
Yeah, you did. You missed a question.
I didn't.
Yeah, you did.
What questions did I miss?
Roman, Wisconsin. I have two yellow dogs in my complex.
Yeah, she's having a conversation with somebody else.
Oh,
on
no, Susan, don't have conversations.
That's why I skipped over.
Oh, I get it. Oh, Anthony Bly says, hi, Jeff. Been a while. Just wanted to say hi, brother. Hey, Anthony, what's going on? So read that one again. Stephanie, right? Stephanie Clyburn?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, read that one again.
I have an appointment to get my GSD fixed 2 days after coming back from board and train. Should I try to space that out more so she can work on her training for a little bit at home?
Yeah, I would. I would. Because then your dog, hold on, is it a female or a male? Get my dog GSD fixed.
She.
The dog?
It says she. So she can work on her training a little bit more.
So that's going to be a longer recovery. So from a spay. So that'll be a little bit of a longer recovery. I would wait a little bit. I would wait a little bit. Because I want you to, we do a 90-day go home, meaning for 90 days, we want you to be really, really strict. So I want you to master at least like place, right? So your dog at least can, you're capable of having your dog go to a dog bed and relax. I would wait at least 2 weeks. I'd reschedule it out for 2 more weeks. Next.
Lori.
Yep.
Throw bonker on their head or body. Can also just hit them on their head with bonker without throwing?
Yeah, if you want to. The bonker is great for like tossing at the head. It's a cotton towel. Anything that startles the dog. Next.
Kayla, what are your thoughts on deer periods?
Fear.
Oh, fear. And what types of protocols do you have during a fear period?
If you're talking about if you're talking about puppy raising, so when there's a puppy, just do as much confidence building as you can and advocate for the dog. When dogs are puppy, my puppy training protocols are way different. Like none of this stuff is really applicable towards a puppy. So that's all different. That's all different. Everything is usually good except for I'll stop biting and jumping and whining. Those are the three major things that I stop. But for its fear period, you just want to do a lot of confidence building and a lot of structure. Do a lot of structure, but it's your job to protect your dog. It's your job to protect your dog. Next.
Marilyn, can you explain the bonkers again, and can I use it for dog aggression? Dakota is the bully to Sadie.
Yeah, but you have to know. So when you've got dog aggression, guys, it's not one thing. It's rehabbing dog aggression. There's like 50 things that you need to do. It's a really intensive process. In my industry, it's a specialty. Not too many dog trainers can stop fighting dogs at all. So it's more than the bonker. You want to have lots of structure in the house. You want to be crating them separately. You want to have lots, you know, no dogs on the furniture, no dogs in the bed, cut down on affection, hold them accountable for even the smallest things, like going through thresholds, going in and out of the crates. Make sure if they get they got to make sure when you tell them down, they lie down, hold them accountable for stuff like that. If they get up, there should be a firmer correction. But the actual aggression then there, you want to use remote collars to get that going. You want to get remote collars to get that going. You need to make sure you muzzle train both dogs, and then you want to remote collar train them, and then you're going to use remote collars. But rehabbing dog aggression in the same house, that's intense. That's really, really intense. So, but what the bonker would do is you don't do it to break up a dog fight. They're not going to feel it. People take 2x4s to dogs' heads during dog fights. They don't care about it. They're fighting. They're fighting. So what it is a bonker is best used pre-fight when the dog is thinking about it. But aggression, though, the last thing I want someone to do is try to use, you know, any tool to break up a dog fight without knowing how to actually break up a dog fight. But we don't have dog fights because we spend so much time making sure that we understand dogs, and we punish before they actually fight. Next.
Anthony Bly says, I'm not the Anthony from Nazareth, Pennsylvania, but from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, but it's all good. I own knucklehead canine.
Yeah, I know who you are. I know. Yeah, well, I was saying, but you're not AFT. You're knucklehead. Yeah. Anthony was AFT. Yeah, I know who you are, Anthony. See, it has been a while. It's been probably last I saw you was on Periscope, probably. Probably Periscope. Next.
Caitlin. My five-month-old pup is starting to become territorial of me when other dogs are around, just not our other dog. If I pay attention to dogs, she growls at them. This only happens with me. How do I correct?
So it's a relationship issue. I would correct with you can correct a lot of ways. You can use a bonker on a dog. Don't let your dog resource guard you. At 5 months old, if you don't get a handle on this now, they won't grow out of it. It'll make it worse. Your dog will be attacking dogs. I'm not trying to scare you, but that's how it starts. So I would let your – what it is if your dog is only doing it with you, it's an unbalanced relationship. So a lot of times at the beginning – I'm glad you asked because a lot of times at the beginning people are like, oh, the dog is jealous. The dog cares about me. No. Think about like an abusive partner, right? Think about that. Think about if you've got a partner that every time you talk to somebody, they go over and they beat the shit out of them. That's not love. That's not love at all. Jealousy is not love. So what I would do is you want to make sure that that dog knows, hey, I pet who I want to pet. You over there and mind your own business and be quiet. You have no decision in any of this. So what do? You can use a leash correction. No. Pop. Bonker. No. Bonk. Remote cower. No. This. But also, what's up that structure? What kind of structure? Get that dog out of your bed if you're sleeping with it. Cut down on cuddle time. The dog should be in a crate. Hold that dog accountable. Cut down on that affection dramatically. Hold that dog accountable. So you're getting a little bit unbalanced. At 5 months old, let's catch that now. Let's knock it out now. You don't knock it out now, you're going to be chasing this for the life of the dog. Next.
This one's from Stephanie. My GSD was on a flat collar today, and I was trying to walk her to see if we made progress, and she kept lunging and now has been throwing up all day. Vet check in the morning.
Stephanie, it's because you choked your dog. Listen, guys, stop walking dogs on flat collars. Please stop. Just stop. What you probably did was your dog got harmed. I wouldn't take it to the vet. There's probably nothing they can do. There's probably nothing they can do about it. Don't waste the money. You know, what are they going to do? The dog probably has some bruising. If the vet says, oh, have you been using a prong collar? That's what did it? Huh, you got a stupid ass vet. No way. Absolutely not. Prong collar doesn't do that. So that's from the flat buckle collar. And that's from the dog pulling on it. And you were literally choking your dog. It's funny because everybody freaks out about if you have to hold up a dog. So the dog tries to bite me, we hold them up in the air. All right. Why? Because if not, we get bit. It's called survival. Everybody freaks out about that. Meanwhile, instead of this, just lower your arms like that and let the dog pull. It's the same exact thing, except for it's more intense and it goes on for longer. So that's why. Don't get rid of your prong collars, guys. Just don't do it. Stop. Prong collar on the dog. And a lot of trainers will say, well, then you didn't do a good job training the dog. That's ego. That's a dog trainer's ego talking. If they truly cared about owners, they would say, hey, does the prong collar make your life better? Owner says, yes, it does. Trainer says, then keep doing it. Okay, next.
I'm actually done.
Why?
It's 8:30.
Oh, ask one more question. And then you'll pop in if you don't mind. You sure?
Cora.
Okay.
My Yorkie is fearful of men severely. She gets really nasty even with my dad. She stays with my parents on nights I work 12 plus hours, so it's a problem. She barks and growls at him for no reason. Help.
Okay. So Cora, how old is the dog? Oh, 12 hours. I thought it was a 12-year-old dog. All right. I'll answer the question. You got to go?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Love you. You got to do your own show?
Yep.
All right.
You have to move the chair.
Oh, sorry. Get in there, Joelle. All right, so this is what I want you to do. This is Joelle. She's interning with me for 3 months. She just finished month one. So what I want you to do is this. Number one, it's possible that your folks, what they need to do is you need to shut this down. What I would tell your parents to do is to not try to be the dog's best friend. We're right there. So try not to be the dog's best friend, number one. So be careful about affection. Too much pressure makes dogs growl. Number two, what I would do is you've got to work your dog around more men. You've got to get your dog to stop the nonsense. It's a very long process to get the dog probably more comfortable with men. Keep a leash on the dog. Keep a leash on the dog. Make sure you're not babying the dog. If you have any dog that's aggressive towards anybody, or any dog that's fear-based, or anything with anxiety-based, you have to dramatically cut down on the affection of the dog. You have to stop babying the dog. It will make it worse. It'll make it worse. It's a drug for your dog. All it does is fuel the aggression, fuels the fear, and fuels the anxiety. Happens every time. So the problem is that it sounds counterproductive. Oh, so you're mean to the dog? I don't think being firm with your dog, I don't think by setting rules and boundaries and consequences is mean at all. I think it's love. I think it's love. You got yourself a drug addict. You think love is going to fix it? Love and understanding? Hell no. You're dealing with an alcoholic. You think love and understanding is going to fix it? Oh, if we love you enough, you'll stop drinking? Hell no. Absolutely not. Nope. Nope. Best way to bury your head in the sand. So what you're going to want to do is I would food train that dog. I would teach it all its basic commands. If it growls at your father, get yourself a bonker. You'll say no, bonk the dog. And I know it's a Yorkie. You won't use this big of a bonker, but no, boom. You have to apply a punisher. Punisher for growling. Then teach your parents how to work the dog. The dog should be in a crate at your parents' house. I'd keep a little slip lead on that dog at all times. A lot of these questions are Skype-based. See, a lot of these answers need to be a Skype. We do Skype. You can join my Patreon page. Patreon.com. Melissa, will you put that up? Patreon.com/solidcaninetraining. Okay, let's get that up there. And I only say that because I can answer questions in depth. These I can only usually get about for a minute. Next.
Kurt S. Dog gets nervous on walks when cars come from behind, but fine when coming head on, even though they're closer. How can I work through this?
Remember I talked about remote collar healing the dog? Remote collar heal the dog, proper equipment on the dog, which we keep mentioning. Get that dog to go. This is the philosophy. I know you're nervous, dog, but you got to walk next to me anyway. All right? Because they want to go into flight mode. And when they want to go into flight mode, they're probably going to want to run past you or break away. Sometimes they'll run right into traffic. They have no idea. Or they'll hunker down. So teach that dog. It's like, I know you're afraid, but you got to walk next to me. You got to walk next to me. Next.
Stephanie, my GSC learned place, sit, paw, and down for me researching your videos, my man. Thank you so much.
You're all right, Stephanie. Fist bump. Thanks. Love you.
You go, what difference between aggression and reactivity?
Oh, a huge difference. Aggression is intent to harm. Intent to harm. So most dogs are reactive and very few are aggressive. So reactive is you're walking a dog on a leash. Please don't do this. But you're walking a dog on a leash and it's like barking its head off and it's lunging and you drop the leash and it runs over to the other dog and says hi. That's just reactivity. Don't do that though. Don't test it. Aggression would be the dog goes over and attacks the dog. That's aggression. So aggression is intent to harm. Next.
Pam B, 8-month-old. When I tell her to sit, she downs. How to fix?
Correct the dog. Keep a leash on the dog, and when the dog lies down, lift the leash up. Lift the leash up. You can step into the dog. So if you're facing the dog, you can, and the dog's legs are like this, you can step into the dog as you're lifting up. You would say no, and you can say sit again, and you sit. And for the next, just do like hundreds and hundreds of sits. Do that. Next.
Susan.
That's common, by the way. Next.
When starting to train with a prong collar on a dog for the first time, can I layer the e-collar right away, or should I introduce the prong for a few days?
I would do a few days. A few days of prong, layer remote. Next.
This always scrolls down so far.
Anthony says, yep.
Yeah.
Yep, Periscope days, LOL. Yep, Anthony, I remember you, buddy. Next.
Lisa, my Malamute gently grabbed a cat's head and just stood there for
a second. Hold on, you missed Susan Olson's. Camo is also resource guarding of me. Will work on me in Indiana in September. Teach that dog the out command too. What you can do is you can out the dog away from you. So we dealt with I think we documented this. We had a perfect example. It was over in Scotland. We had a woman named Elizabeth whose dog was resourcing guarder. We taught the dog out with a remote collar, literally get out of here. So the dog's but right next to you, another dog comes over, the dog growls, you say out, push that button down. Someone behind you has a leash, guides the dog away. You're literally saying to the dog, get out of here. That's what we do with resource guarding of people. Next.
Okay, Stephanie. Okay, thank you. I didn't mean to hurt her. I've been working with her on a prong collar and wanted to see if she made any progress on the flat collar. She's so stubborn.
So, Stephanie, I know you didn't mean to hurt her, and I'm not implying that. Nobody wants to hurt the dog. You have a GSD. Keep using the prong. Keep using the prong. It makes your life better. That's all that matters. That's all that matters. Don't go back. How long do I use the prong for? Use it for the rest of the dog's life. And a lot of my colleagues will tell you that, then you did a bad job training. So you did a bad job training. Who gives a shit? I can walk my dog down the street and I can drink a cup of coffee and I can text at the same time. Or I can hold my, or I can hold the kid or hold my lover's hand. Who gives a shit? It's like, don't let the egos of dog trainer, you know, get in the way. And I got a big ego, but I care way more about human beings. That's how my ego is fueled by helping as many humans as possible. Next.
Anthony Bly, great advice, Jeff. You're the man. Hustle, hustle, hustle. Make these people smart.
Thanks.
Lisa, okay. My Malamute gently grabbed a cat's head and just stood there for a split second. I calmly said no and a small leash pop. She let it go. No injury. Thanks for being in my head to remain calm, not angry.
Awesome, Lisa. Proud of you.
Brittany, I want to get into board and train over the next year. I own two dogs, have done lots of training and structure, but one is not very dog friendly. Advice to be successful, don't want to stress my dog.
Put your dog away whenever you have dogs over. Separate your personal dogs from your client dogs. Never let them interact. Never let them interact. And then teach your dog to be around other dogs. So having your dog around other dogs, lying in a crate, your board and train dogs are going to be crated most of the time anyway. So there's no reason why your personal dogs need to commingle with your board and train dogs. Keep them separate. It's a common mistake that whenever I hear about a dog trainer's personal dog attacking a board and train dog, I'm like, what were you thinking? Always separate them. Always keep them separate. Always keep them separate. Next.
Susan. Hi, Susan. Dawn. Or Sean,
Sean.
Sorry.
Yep.
My dog pees a little bit when I pull him to give him love and head rubs. I cannot seem to figure out except not to do that. Is this a problem? The dog pees when I pull him over to me?
Yeah. Don't do it, right? Doctor, every time I drink a cup of coffee, I get a massive pain in my eyeball. You know what the doctor says to me? Jeff, take the spoon out of the cup, right? So it's like, yeah, if I was doing something, if I was pulling my dog over to me and he peed, it's probably more of a nervous fear response than it is excitement, I would imagine. Because if it was excited, the dog would come over to you voluntarily. So be careful about putting your emotional needs in front of the dog's progress. So be really, really careful about that. Now, you can train the dog to recall to you, and then sit and then take affection. That's what I would do. That's what I would do. But if I pulled my wife and tried to give her a kiss, she'd kick me in the nuts. I mean, and if it's just the truth. So I want my wife to come loving over to me. I want my children to come running over to me. Papa, we love you. And they jump into my arms. It's not get over here and give me a hug, right? So just think about that. Next.
Kayla, I'm not challenging your information, but I'm curious, why do you say cut the affection with a fearful dog? You say it fuels it and makes it worse. Why do you know why this is or can further explain why?
Kayla, you can challenge me all you want, you know, but I just don't want false information spread because affection is a reward. That's why. Rewards, rewards give you more of something. Fearful dogs need confidence. They don't need love. They need confidence. So what happens is this. Dogs afraid of, this is what very happens all the time. Dogs afraid of something. You put your hand down. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. guess what you're doing? You're telling the dog that it is okay to be afraid. That it is okay to be afraid. That's what you're saying. And no, Jeff, I'm not saying you're saying this, but a lot of people are like, no, I'm telling my dog it's okay not to be afraid of something. Because why? We work with tons of fearful dogs, and we know affection doesn't work. Now, you're always going to get somebody out there that says, oh, no, Jeff, after 2 years, I rehab my dog. I'm like, 2 years? So you let your dog stay in a fear state for 2 years? That's the way I look at it. So the more structure, the more consequences for things that are not acceptable, punishment for things that are absolutely not acceptable, your dog is going to work through that fear, and they'll build their confidence. They'll build their confidence. Next.
Spinisper, dog wants to scent mark frequently on walks, punishable offense or natural behavior?
It's a natural behavior, but so is biting other dogs, right? So is jumping on people. So is barking its head off whenever it sees somebody. So these are natural behaviors. So is probably running down the street, right? So is chasing a rabbit, chasing a deer. So to me, I don't want you marking on the walk, especially. And if I've got dogs that are very territorial or aggressive, I don't let them mark. I don't even let them mark out in, you know, in the yard. Next.
Are you coming back to San Diego in 2019?
Most likely. Yep.
Cora, life change with the prong e-collar comes next week when the correct contact points come in. We will definitely do a Skype with you. With my parents are very nervous about tools. Thanks, Jeff.
Yep. Yeah, Cora. Yeah, I mean, they could be nervous about tools, but I don't know how old you are, Cora. I was going to think if you're a teenager, but you're not. You're the one that has whose parents watch it. You know, the reason why they're nervous about tools is because they don't want to hurt the dog. Because they don't want to hurt the dog. Guess what? I don't want to hurt the dog either. I don't want to hurt the dog either. That's why getting this information out there is so important out there, so people understand how to train a dog. You can hurt a dog without a tool. Dogs have been hurt way before prong collars and remote collars were around, right? Way before. People are hurting dogs around the world, and they're not using tools. They're not using any of these tools. So I get it, though. Next. No, Grant, thanks for the $1.99.
Please explain all situations you would use out.
Well, I got all situations. Grant, I'll give you a couple of situations. I use out for when I'm playing ball. So when I'm playing ball, I use out. I use out for when I'm playing tug. I do out if I'm doing bite work. So on an arm sleeve or a suit, I use the word out. If there's anything in my dog's mouth I don't want it to be, I'll say out. I'll also use the word out, meaning to get out of here, to get out of here. Next. And that might not be every one of them, but those are a lot of them.
This is another one from Grant. Please explain how to use commands when teaching a dog to swim. Watched a video countless times, but still confused on how to use command and reward markers for swimming.
Stop with your command and reward markers. Get out of your dog training mind, Grant, buddy. Get out of it. Just teach the dog to swim. There's no command and reward markers for swimming. In my opinion, there's just not. Forget it. Forget the marker thing. You don't be so technical. Watch my videos on YouTube. Do you see, watch my videos. All my stuff is not very technical. It's not technical. Everyone's getting technical. You don't need to be technical. It's just swimming. So watch the videos. The reason why that it's confusing because you're looking too deep into it. You're looking too hard into it, right? Just watch, do what the video says, literally, leash on the dog, do what the video says, your dog will go swimming. And if you got a dog with ball drive, it's that much easier.
Stephanie, when my GSD is on an e-collar, she acts amazing, but as soon as it comes off, it's like she knows and turns back to biting and ornery. What to do?
Stop taking off the e-collar. Guys, stop taking off your tools. Stop taking off your tools. All right? Now, it's possible that you haven't gone to punishment mode. If you've got a biting dog, that remote collar should probably be on a lot. But it's possible that you haven't used it at a high enough level to extinguish the behavior. But if I had a dog that was biting, I don't know if it's biting you, biting other dogs, biting other people, but I'd keep that on for insurance purposes. Absolutely. Also, how long have you been using it for? 1 month, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years? You know, it takes 4,000 repetitions to get a dog to be reliably trained with food. We use food, but we don't use it that much because we don't want to do 4,000 repetitions. Might as well cut the learning curve by using better tools, Next.
Aussie service dogs. How do you let go of your nerves when working with an aggressive issue and remain calm and remain confident? It can be discouraging sometimes.
I'm a professional, not to be cocky. Yeah, you have to remember how many dogs I've worked with. And also going back to Kayla's question about the fear, I've worked with so many fearful dogs. We have the formula. It's not the ultimate formula. It's not the only formula, but it's the formula that works for us. With aggression, I know being nervous doesn't work. So then I don't do it, right? I don't do it because it doesn't work. It doesn't help. If you're working with aggression and you're nervous, you probably shouldn't do it. You shouldn't do it because you're going to get bit. You're going to get bit or you're going to make a mistake. So you got to be careful. You got to be super careful. Yeah. Aggression is not easy to work with. A lot of young dog trainers are drawn to it, but they shouldn't be doing it. When I first got into dog training, I did, and I got bit a lot. I've been mauled 3 times. I was working dogs way above my pay grade. I shouldn't have been working these dogs, but I did. I made pretty good progress too. Now none of us are getting bit and we're working with really, really serious dogs. So next.
Philippe, hi, my dog whines when we are going out for a walk. Should I punish that? He whines just in home.
My dog whines when we're going for a walk. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, why? Well, hold on, Philippe. Yeah, because what I would say is, do you like the whining? You probably don't like the whining because that's why you asked the question. So I would say you probably don't like the whining, so stop the whining. The whining is most likely from excitement. I can't stand whining. I don't like it from my kids. I don't like it from my dogs. I don't like it from, you know, someone I'm having a relationship with. I'm not going to say my wife because she'll hit me. I'm having a relationship with her and nobody else, but you know what I'm saying? Next.
Here's another one from Grant. What command do you use to stop inappropriate play? Done, off, just want to address one dog, not all dogs.
I'll usually say enough. You can attach any word to anything. Pizza could be stop. Pizza could be stop playing, and chicken parm could be start playing. So you tell me. You can use the word off. Not off, I'm sorry. You can use the word enough, quiet, no, stop, whatever you want. Next.
Lisa, what's been your favorite dog-friendly city to visit?
Oh, I don't know, Lisa. I'm not one of those, you'll never see me at like, what do they call those? Those yappy hours?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you're not going to ever see me at a yappy hour. You're not going to see me like, let's see. I like Greenville, South Carolina as a city just in general, I like warm weather climates. I don't know. Lisa, you actually got me stumped there because I've never considered a city. I never look at a city and say, wow, this is a pet friendly city. That's just not where my head's at. I like meeting people. So with my dogs, when I travel on the road, and my dogs are with me in the RV, and if we're going to go out for dinner to an outdoor cafe, I usually leave my dogs back in the RV. I usually, even if dogs are allowed on the patio, I leave my dogs in the RV. Why? Just because. I don't want people coming over to my dogs. I don't want people trying to pet my dogs. I want to enjoy my meal. That's why. So I don't know. I'm probably not the one to ask. But I like Greenville, South Carolina, though. Next.
From Stephanie, my GSC is 4 months old, been using e-collar for about 1 month. She bites me and my family. It goes to 100, and I've only went to 65 on shock so far, and she yelps. Should I go higher?
Well, if your dog's biting you and your family, you've got bigger problems. That needs a Skype session. The last thing I want you to do is just be pushing a button when the dog's trying to bite. That's a Skype. You got a serious issue. You got a dog that's got 1 foot in the grave, so we can't have that. So what I would do is, it's going to be bigger than that. It's not going to just be just about that. it's going to be a lot more protocols, a lot more structure. There's probably going to be some management involved as well. But yeah, you can go as high as 100 if you want to. But again, it's more than that. It's always more than that. It's more than just dog bites, punish. You need to start, what you need to start doing is recognizing the signs and attacking the signs. Also, you might be doing things not on purpose that are actually encouraging your dog to bite more. Not on purpose. So what you've got to do is you might have to do a little bit of a lifestyle change. Next.
Pam B, dog well, crate trained, except when I get her
out.
Hold on,
it looks like you missed some here. What? Lisa, what's been your favorite? Right after that, Jimmy Luke, can we listen to live in Spotify? Oh, Jimmy Luke, not only on the replay, but people on Spotify can't hear that.
Gotcha.
Just remember, this is on Spotify, SoundCloud, and Google. So if something's written, the folks won't be able to read it. They can't hear it. Next.
Pam B, dog well crate trained, except when I get her out after being gone all day. She's overexcited. No tools on to help correct because no collars and crate when not here. What suggestions do you have?
Bonker. Dog comes out of the crate all excited. No. Boom. Just like that. No. And then boom. Sounds mean because your dog's happy to see you. Sorry, I can't have you all excited, all acting like a fool. Next.
Susan, with fireworks and thunderstorms, I take Camo to the patio and ask her, what's that? We make it a game and she calms down. Is that an okay to deal with?
I wouldn't do that, Susan, but if it's working for you, keep doing it. Next.
Spinisper, puppy protocols, what are your recommendations for the first few weeks home, 8 through 12 weeks?
Oh, tons. I can't answer that question in such a short period of time. There's a ton of stuff you want to be doing. You're literally shaping the rest of the dog's life in those 4 weeks. So dog should be about 20 hours in the crate. Don't carry the dog around. You'll be picking up the dog, doing protocols with it, but it's all food training. So everything they do is with food. Dog should have a slip lead on. Everything is food. Your eyes should never be leaving your dog. You should always know where your dog is. If you're not working your dog, Dog goes in the crate. You're going to be working on all your basic commands. You can work on sit, down, place, recall, tons of recall games. Kenneling up, do that. Get that dog to, when it comes over to you, four on the floor, sits. That's the only way it gets paid. I would be careful about your tone of voice. Don't let other dogs meet it, because if it has a bad experience, it'll F it up for the rest of the dog's life most likely. Lots of structure, do tons of confidence building. Get that dog to be on a bunch of different surfaces, cement, grass, sand, gravel, uneven surfaces. Get that dog to climb over things, to climb under things, to go through things. Expose that dog to hundreds and hundreds of sounds, all when you're doing food training. So you get the dog to be exposed to all these different environmentals, all while you're doing food training. So next.
Stephanie, do you use a kennel for punishment or no? I haven't, but I've been told yes, use it for punishment, and then told absolutely not.
Putting a dog in a kennel is not a punishment. I mean, I guess technically the lack of free movement is technically a punishment, but what are you doing? Bad dog, go in the kennel? No. Life's too short. We got things to do. Now, I put dogs in kennels because why? I'm leaving the house. Or it's overnight, but I'm never bad dog, go in your kennel. I never say bad dog anyway, but it's like what you did was wrong. I'll address that now. Now let's move on. People use crates as a punishment because they don't know how to properly punish and they have nothing else to do. That's all they know how to do. So no. And I'm not worried about making a negative association with a crate. That's not what it's about. It's about that it's not an effective punisher. My dog bites me. I put it in a crate. No. My dog jumps on someone, I put in the crate. No. My dog barks too much, I put in the crate. No. Like, no. My dog whines, I put in the crate. No. So, no, I can't imagine using it as a punisher. Next.
Yuko, how can I train my dog around reactive dogs? My Aussie going to group class for 3 months due to reactivity. He was getting better, but one of the dogs from group class barked aggressive in his face. Since that day, he started barking aggressive to reactive dogs. How can I get his trust again?
Well, the teacher should have corrected that other dog. like if a dog ran up to my dog and started barking its face, I mean, I'd probably kick the dog. But, you know, oh my God, Jeff kicks dogs. If that's the narrative you guys want to repeat, what I'm saying is, you know, what I'm saying is someone should have corrected that dog. You have to advocate for your dog, right? So I can't, you know, do some of you have dogs out there that can, I'm sure there's plenty of dogs out there that if you had a dog run up to and bark in its face, would just look at it. In fact, we have dogs at our training center that would just go, whatever, I don't care. But not many, not the dogs that I work with. And my dog sure as hell wouldn't, you know? But can I walk by reactive dogs? Yes. But barking in its face, that's dog trainer fail. That's class, that's group class fail. That's what that was. Next.
Sean Diller, are you ever near Toledo, Ohio, or Ohio in general?
Yeah, Sean, we just launched the Canton, Ohio seminar today. Go to RV Dog Trainer, rvdogtrainer.com. We just announced the Canton, Ohio. It'll sell out. Everybody's been wanting to get me to Canton for a long time. I mean, to Ohio for a long time. We finally did it. Next.
How did you teach your dogs the enough command to get them to stop playing with each other? My dogs play well, just need to teach them how to stop when I need their focus.
Probably my relationship with my dogs. Probably my relationship. A lot of this stuff is just relationship based, you know, but you can't do that with usually board and trained dogs because you can't really build a good relationship with them. You can use a remote collar. Use a remote collar. Throw a bonker in the mix. Take a bonker, say no or enough, whiz it at them. They should stop. Get a dressage whip, knock them on the butt, remote cower because they'll probably be too far away from you. But don't tell them, don't give them an obedience command. Don't say like focus or look at me while they're in drive. They're not going to. They're going to blow you off. You'll just get frustrated. Next.
This is Grant. What command do you use to address one dog's inappropriate play? You skipped my super chat. I know. I didn't get the notification. Like, it usually gives me, like, a big green notification, but we answered that, right?
What?
What command for inappropriate play from Grant?
Yeah. I think we did. Thanks for the super chat. Everybody can see you doing the super chat, too, by the way, Grant. Just to let you know. Everybody can see it, but you're right. People on Spotify can't hear about it. So, yeah. Grant hasn't stopped donating money. But it's not about the command. Remember, Grant, don't be so command-focused. Buddy, we've had this conversation before. Don't be so command-focused. So what command do I use? The command doesn't matter. The question is, how do you stop your dog? So you can. So let's use the word enough. So enough is the word. So I can say my dog's name, girl, and I can say enough. Just like that. And that's the tone. Now, if they have a remote collar on, I would say enough, and then I'd hit the remote collar. Now the dog knows what the word enough means. Or I can say no command, just hit the remote collar, and they'll stop. So you have two things, two different ways to do it there. Next.
Lisa, any bark collar work for long, low howls? I've tried three so far. All fails.
Have you tried the E-Collar Technologies new ultra-sensitive collar that has the odometer on it? If you haven't, try that one. There's not any good ones out there that'll do that howl, that low howl. All right. End of the line. Was there a question you were supposed to answer? Go to T3 first?
Yeah, definitely go to T3 first.
Why?
It's everything you need to know if you're looking in. She's a groomer and wants to start training dogs, correct?
Yeah.
So T3 not only sets you up with the skills you'll need, but it's the mindset behind everything. I think training dogs is probably the easier part of it all, and it's more so just getting your head right to be able to take on that commitment and to start the business, if that's what your goal is right, to start a business, and to just have this team of people like backing you up and getting you over through all these hurdles. And there's a lot of stuff going on in there that you probably don't even think about and didn't know was holding you back until you sit down and they start kind of picking things apart.
So you do a private session with Jeff.
Exactly. Yeah. And then you're like, oh, I didn't know that was, I was struggling with that.
I didn't know I have prosperity issues, you know, consciousness exactly. issues.
And self-worth issues. Right. Like all these things kind of boil right. to the surface.
Right. Right.
It's just so worth it. It's worth every penny.
Right. I know. All right, everybody. We're done. We've been on here for, it's an hour and 30 minutes. It's time to go. I'll be back on again probably Saturday. So I want to thank everybody so much for tuning in. Thank you, everybody on Spotify, SoundCloud, iTunes, Google, probably some other platforms that we're on that I don't even know about. Obviously, YouTube Live. Thank you so much. Love you. And we'll talk to everybody soon.